Hey folks, so there's an update on my second entry into the Warts and All Facebook group's Eastern Front group build. This is my Panzer IV diorama for the Battle of Moscow that I'm doing. So the buildings are done, well, almost done. The roof on the shed barn thing still needs to be sorted out. I don't know if I'm going to go with a thatched roof or a corrugated sheet metal roof. Or just a flat sheet metal roof. I don't know yet. Probably going to go with thatch roof. Thatch roof is much more difficult for me to do, but, I mean, I have the materials. I mean, I've got a giant length of, plumber's hemp that a friend of mine sent to me from Germany, because I can't get it here. So, you know, I'll probably end up just using that. This is really time consuming. I mean, the building's enough. The silo was pretty friggin' time consuming to build, because it's all done with individual bricks, right? It's these are all individual bricks that I had to glue on there one at a time, and it took quite a bit of time to do that. But you know, I'm fairly happy with it. The roof is, well, it's just sheet metal. That's what it's supposed to look like with you know, copper strips or whatever you call them. I don't really know. I don't build roofs, so I just looked at the picture and went, yeah, that sort of looks like it. A friend of mine will shake his head and go, no, it doesn't look anything like it, but that's okay. It's good enough that I think it looks a bit like a roof, and that's all it needs to do is make me think it looks like a roof, so it's doing that. So the thatched roof, I mean, I just need the structure for that, and the thatch just gets glued on, and you won't see any of this mess that's on there. I did it this way in case I wanted to put a hole in it. Then I could have some of the wood showing through. But I'm pretty sure I'm not going to do that. So it's kind of I could have just done it with foam board. But I wanted to see if I could do it anyway, which is why it looks like that. The pile of rubble that the Panzer IV is sitting on is meant to be, it will be eventually, kind of a rock wall that matches the base of the silo. It's going to extend around to probably just underneath the tank here, and the tank is driving through it. So a lot of it will be shattered and laying on the surface of the diorama because the tank drove through the wall and knocked it down. But for all intents and purposes, this thing's ready to start the next phase of the work, which is, starting the surface work for the diorama and paintwork. I can't put the thatch roof on the, barn until I get the barn painted. So the first thing I'm going to do is paint the barn. And then I can put the thatch roof on, and then I don't have to worry about it anymore. I can just put it on the diorama whenever I want. I might do the silo at the same time. So the vehicles, I'm going to do all the vehicles for both this diorama and my Tiger 1 diorama, which is still sitting behind me on the shelf, all at the same time, just because it's easier for me to do that. Now the bricks that are on the shed. Excuse me, guys. I'll address a question that was asked about this. Now, if you notice, the bricks look a little bit different now. They're not really bricks, they're stones, piled stones. That's because I've textured them now. I've added basically individual deformations to each stone on the wall. And I did that on purpose, and I used a specific tool to do it. And it's not hard, and the tools are dirt cheap. I'll just reach past the microphone here. The tools are pretty rudimentary to do the texturing on that. I did the bulk of it with this thing here, but it's basically, you can use a pencil. This is just a piece of sharpened. I put a dowel in a pencil sharpener. I sharpened it. So this I used to do a lot of stonework, rough stonework like that. But I also will use a pencil. If it's difficult to see the stones, I'll use a pencil because the pencil will leave marks, right, where this doesn't. So I use one or the other depending on what I want to do. And then I have these things. I have a whole parcel of these things. They're basically double-ended styluses that have different sized balls on them. It's good to have balls of various sizes. You never know when you need them. I just got them on Amazon here in Canada, which is hard to do anyway, but and they're like $3 Canadian, so what's that price of rubber chicken, I guess. And I think it came with a set of five different ones. And so after I embossed all the brickwork, I mean, I can emboss the brickwork with this too if I want, right? So I can trace out the bricks using the stylus and then take a slightly larger version of this and then just depress the center of the bricks. And it's literally as fast as I'm doing it here, right? And you add variation to the surface so it's not all smooth. It makes it look like stones. I've been doing this for quite a while, doing this to the surface of bricks, to bricks, and or not bricks, stones. When I do stone bridges and stuff like that, it makes them more interesting. It also makes them take a wash better too. So, but yeah, so that's how I do that. And it's very time consuming, but you put a good movie on and you just kind of get lost in it. So it's not that hard. For this, it's literally this stuff here. This is a sheet of cork that I bought at the local craft store, right? And I cut it into very thin strips with my metal ruler and my hobby knife. And then I chopped those thin strips into tiny little bricks. And then I just dip each one in a little blob of glue and stick them on one at a time until I wound my way all the way up. Now you can do it so it's like actual traditional brickwork, so you got, you know, they're like overlapping, so they're not all piled up in a row or all piled, you know, in a disorganized fashion like this. But I wanted it to look like this because I'm actually fashioning it after a specific silo that I saw a picture of. So I'm mimicking the kind of disordered stone pile, medieval sort of stonework that I saw in the photo, which is why it looks like this. But, you know, you can also use the same, as long as you keep the bricks all about the same size, you can do like actual normal masonry work, right? So it's not a stretch of the imagination to do that. The roof is just copper sheet. I mean, this isn't really anything to show you. I mean, it's a pretty shit job, but you know, it's gonna get covered in moss and stuff, so I don't really care. So it's just I made a frame out of these. These are almost cocktail sticks. That's what I call them. They're cocktail sticks that nobody bothered to sharpen. I got these at the local craft store. And I use these to make it like a pyramid frame, right? I just glued them together all at the top. Actually, I put them together in upside down in this thing. And so I had them all. Oh, come on. So I literally, I can't really see what I'm doing because the microphone's right in front of my freaking face. Anyway, I put a blob of glue in the top of this thing, and then I stuck these things in it. So it made a pyramid. I can show you pictures. Actually, yeah, it's easier than me doing this. So anyway, I made like a pyramid out of that thing, and I just put a blob of glue in there and glued into the shape that I wanted, and then I took that and glued it to the top of the silo, and then I attached these strips of that copper craft copper sheet to it that I had cut, and then I put ribs on and a little cap, which looks like shit, but oh well. Like I said, it's all going to get covered in moss, so here. The door for the silo in the shed, they all came from a mini art set that I had. I had like two or three of those mini art garden wall sets, and I salvaged the doors out of one of them and decided to use them for this because they're quite handy. And making doors is a bit of a pain in the butt, so I decided I'd just use them. So the next thing, like I said, is I'm going to start painting the shed. That way I can get the thatch on the roof. I've never done thatch like that before. I've done it in a different way only once, and I liked it. It was okay, but this time I want to use it in actual layers of thatch, so I have to figure out how to do that with the hemp that I have, so it could be a bit tricky. If it works, I'll talk you through how I did it and take lots of pictures and stuff like that. If it doesn't, I'll just tell you how I failed. So, so I think that's it. It's pretty simple. Not much to show you, but a lot has happened. Just not much to really show you. It's mostly just boredom and tedium, but that's the nature of most of my videos anyway. Again, as per usual, thank you to my patrons for giving me your support. I do appreciate it. I look forward to it every month. It's because it means I can, you know, buy the next thing for the next project and stuff like that and everything. I mean, I don't really go into that whole, this is exclusive content just for you stuff. I'm not really good at that kind of thing. The whole point of the Patreon for me is folks were always asking, I want to send you something. Can I buy you this? Can I send you that? And I always felt bad about guys trying to do that and then spending the enormous amount of money and shipping. So I'll tell you what, I just set up a Patreon thing. You can save the shipping and you can just tell me what kit it was and I'll see if I can find it myself, right? Or I'll just buy the kit that I want for the project that I have on my goal. Well, rather than buy a kit that I won't use for a project that I haven't envisioned yet. So, and I don't have to, I guess, hurt anyone's feelings or, you know, deal with my own personal guilt because I'm not very good with accepting gifts and stuff like that. So that was the whole purpose of setting up the Patreon. I don't like exclusivity. I hate elitist crap, and I especially hate elitist exclusivity kind of thing. I hate that kind of thing. I'm a socialist, so I don't like that kind of stuff. I think everyone should have the right to everything or just nothing. Right, fair for everybody, but that's just me. I'm weird that way. So again, thanks for your support. I appreciate it. I bought two kits just recently, and the only reason I bought them is because they supported me. So, they're, like I said, they're directly contributing to me making videos and me continuing in the hobby and trying to build some kind of inspirational support for folks that still watch my work, which aren't that many anymore. Hardly anybody watches my videos anymore. That's okay. That's another story. So I don't make videos because I'm trying to get famous or popular or anything like that. The only thing I care about is getting one person or two people to be inspired and build something. That's all I care about. So if I do that, then I won. Yay. So, right, speaking of which, I want to work on this, so I'm going to get to it. I got to clean this up first, though. Pass, foreign contaminant. That's all I got for this. If you guys want to join the Facebook group, the link is in the description below. If you want to support my Patreon, if that's your thing, the link is also below. Link to my Instagram account and my Facebook account is in the link in the description below, and my DeviantArt account is down below. I was thinking about opening up the, because some people don't like Patreon. I've heard there's, I don't know, some kind of stink going on that I don't know about. I've just heard that people don't like it, and I don't know why. I don't care. I was thinking about turning on, activating that join button for YouTube. So, again, I won't be offering exclusive content and shit like that. I don't go for that. But if folks don't like Patreon, I can activate that join button thing, if that matters. So I might look at doing that. Anyway, yeah, I guess that's it. That's all I got. You guys be good. Keep your stick on the ice. Bye for now. Mm-hmm.